Airbus have got their A320, Boeing have got their Boeing 737, and now China has got the COMAC C919. But even though it's only been flying for a short while, and I'm actually going to be flying on it from Hong Kong here today, I don't think introducing a new aircraft type, especially with the restrictions that we'll talk about in this video that have been placed on this Chinese manufacturer, I don't think it's going to be as easy as ABC for COMAC. My name's Steph. I'm a pilot with a commercial license and I've been flying planes for almost 20 years now. However, in early 2024, I had a bit of a medical issue and I was told I could no longer fly as pilot in command. For now, at least. So as I'm working towards flying planes myself again, I'm sharing my aviation experiences and adventures here on YouTube to help encourage you to get out and enjoy the world through aviation yourself. So if you like what you see, be sure to subscribe and join our growing community of aviation lovers. And today, I'm at Hong Kong International Airport ready to try a very exciting new aircraft by a relatively new airline manufacturer that I think you're going to find quite interesting. But whilst having a new airline manufacturer in the industry is obviously a good thing for a competitive point of view, whilst it's really nice to see innovation really being pushed forward by another company, I'm going to quote this next bit because I don't want to get it wrong and get in trouble with China. They've had a bit of a checkered past when it comes to the association and the relationships with other countries. For example, in 2021, the USA, the government actually named COMAC as a company owned or controlled by the People's Liberation Army and therefore prohibited any American companies actually investing in COMAC in the future. Pretty restrictive for a company that's got a really aggressive rollout plan for its aircraft over the next 30 years. Now the COMAC C919 has actually been flying for almost 10 years now. Its first flight was back in 2017. But this flight that I'm doing today from Hong Kong into Shanghai is actually the only flight that the C919 is actually allowed to do anywhere outside of mainland China. Hold that thought, there's just an A330 that's going to go underneath us. But who are COMAC, just in case you haven't heard of them before? Well, it's a Chinese state-owned company and they've actually been around since 2008. And it's not just the C919 they have, they actually have two aircraft that they've manufactured already. The first one was the C909, and that was a smaller twin-engine regional jet, and it was originally known as the ARJ21, but COMAC decided to get their naming convention in order so that it would make more sense when you look at it alongside companies like Airbus and Boeing. So the ARJ21 was renamed the C909. The aircraft I'm flying on today, which is a twin engine, single aisle, narrow body, a bit like the A320 or the 737, that's now the C919. And that naming convention continues throughout their expansion plan as well, which I'll come to a bit later in this video. But they're not just looking to compete with the 787 Dreamliners, the A350s, the ultra long range aircraft in the future. No. Their expansion plans go way beyond that. So what about the actual aircraft itself then? Well, I think the easiest way to understand what the C919 is capable of is to compare it to something else that we're already quite familiar with. So let's compare a couple of the basic stats of the COMAC C919 to the Airbus A320. Of course, this depends on the aircraft configuration itself, but typically the C919 is around 160 to 170 passengers compared to the 180 to 190 that you could typically get on the A320. And then when it comes to how far these aircraft can fly, the C919 can get around 2,500 nautical miles of range, which does fall short compared to the A320, which typically is around 3,300 nautical miles, or even more for the A320neo variant.
But then it's not just range or payload that's potentially restrictive for this aircraft as well, because regulation comes into play when people like the FAA, who regulate the airspace mainly in Northern America, and EASA, who regulate the airspace over Europe, have both come out and said that they're not going to certify this aircraft to fly in those regions. In fact, earlier this year, EASA actually said that they're unlikely to give certification to the C919 to be able to fly anywhere within Europe for at least another 3 to 6 years. So as an aircraft, it's slower than the A320. It can't carry as many people as an A320. And from a regulation point of view, it's restricted in terms of where it can fly in the world. So why should we actually care then about the COMAC C919?
Well, firstly, there's the potential benefits of introducing a new competitor to the market, a market that's been dominated by Boeing and Airbus for many years now. Secondly, there's the potential to drive innovation in the sector as well, because whilst a lot of components for the C919, things like the power plants, some cabin systems, the avionics, in-flight entertainment, power, fire protection and lighting systems are actually sourced from foreign companies, if China brings more of that in-house in the future, and this obviously depends on how willing China are to share this with the rest of the world, but new ways of thinking could potentially benefit the aviation sector as a whole. Then also you've got a backlog of deliveries which Airbus is struggling to deliver, the trade tensions between the US and China as well at the moment, which may encourage more Chinese companies to potentially buy locally when it comes to sourcing their aircraft. Are they going to be the new number one aircraft manufacturer worldwide? Well, no, not in the short term at least. So for now at least, it does feel like the COMAC C919 is basically just a locally made aircraft servicing the local area. It'll be interesting to see if that does expand beyond China, but for the moment, it doesn't really look like that's going to happen anytime soon. But let's see what it's actually like on board. We're boarding from gate 13, which is only about a 5-minute walk from where I am now. Let's jump on board and see what it's like. Well, there it is. That's the C919 in all its glory. What do you think? I mean, it's got a much rounder nose than something like a 737, but then the windows around the front, they have similarities to the Airbus itself. Little winglets, two LEAP engines that power this thing as well. And I do like as well, they've added C919 to the markings on the ground as well, as when the aircraft is stopping, it knows where to stop. So they've added that to the A321, 320, 319, A220 that also uses this gate, and now the C919. Not sure why the 737 line is slightly further forward. I'm assuming it's because the door on the 737 is set slightly further back than the other aircraft. But here's our tug, which is ready to push the aircraft back. We should be boarding in a minute.
And passenger requiring special assistance. And Scott?
Thank you.
Business class.
Oh, thank you.
Hello, from
Hello.
To Shanghai.
Thank you.
7-8, okay. The second row of the window seat.
Thank you.
This one.
Thank you. So today I'm flying at the front of the COMAC C919 in business class, and I don't know why they did this, but the rows of the aircraft actually start from row 6. There's no 1 to 5. So business class is rows 6 and 7, and then economy fills up the rest of the aircraft. I sat down, I got settled in, I browsed the libations menu. Now in terms of food on this aircraft, I hadn't actually pre-booked a vegetarian meal, that was my mistake, and so I decided not to have the pork or the rice and prawn dish that was offered to me. But as you'll see in a second, the staff were very good and they did look after me in terms of food anyway. The business class seat on this aircraft is actually pretty spacious. There's a little pocket next to your seat where you can store your phone and other things, bottle of water at the front, and it also has pretty good leg room. The seat obviously reclines, and one thing that I do love on an aircraft is that it has actual manual window shades, not the electronically dimmable ones like you get on the 787 Dreamliner. But I reckon one of my favorite things on this aircraft are these kind of retro 80s style air vents, which look like something out of Tron, to be honest. They were fantastic. China Eastern also provide a pair of slippies, which apparently you can take home, so I took them home. And then the safety video came on, but I did notice, and it might just have been our flight, but the volume was incredibly low. I couldn't actually hear what they were saying. However, the screens that they have, really high resolution, especially when you compare them to some of the older screens that you would see on the A320s and Boeing 737s that we're probably used to flying.
Please keep your seatbelt fastened in case of sudden turbulence. Hope you enjoy your flight. Thank you.
And then something interesting about the takeoff roll itself, which I want your help with. So as we were at the holding point, this Airbus A320 actually jumped in front of us. Look at it flexing its higher payload and range on us. But as we get onto the runway, I want you to have a listen to the spool up of the jet engines on this aircraft. Now, normally there's a slight delay of around 3 or 4 seconds from the pilot applying full power to the engines then developing its full takeoff thrust. But have a listen to what happened to us. Power is applied, we're starting to roll, we're waiting for the full power to come in, we're waiting for the engines to spool up, still waiting, rolling a bit further, still waiting, keep rolling down the runway, we're still waiting, still waiting, still waiting, still waiting, and there we go. Does anyone know if that's a standard operating procedure for China Eastern? Is that a COMAC C919 thing? And then another thing that interested me on this flight is as we climbed up, it took an awfully long time for the seatbelt sign to come off. In fact, we actually climbed all the way to our cruise altitude through pretty still air. There was no turbulence, it was very calm, but the seatbelt sign stayed on until we had leveled out at our cruise altitude about 10 minutes after we'd taken off. No big deal, but if you are flying China Eastern or this aircraft in the future, maybe just bear that in mind, especially if you've got kids who might want the loo. After we leveled off and the seatbelt sign was off, then the staff did come round. I was given a hot towel, and then pretty much straight away the seatbelt sign came back on again. And then the food service started, and as I said, because I hadn't booked a specific meal, the staff was still really lovely nonetheless. And so they came round with all the vegetarian things that they could find, which basically was a couple of fruit plates and several bread rolls, which I took on as being a bit of a challenge and decided to eat them all. The in-flight entertainment system in all of its high resolution glory was showing this very interesting show about how to make iPhone covers that look like sheep. Frustrated that I hadn't brought a sewing machine on board with me, I decided to check out the onboard Wi-Fi, but couldn't actually get this one to work, and I couldn't work out also how to translate this into English. So do bear that in mind, if you want to use the in-flight Wi-Fi and you only speak English, you might want to work out how the system works before you jump on board.
So we're about an hour and a half into the flight now, just gone into a little bit more cloud over mainland China, so the seatbelt sign's gone back on again. I know I've been talking a lot about the COMAC C919, the actual aircraft in this video so far, but I should make mention of China Eastern, who are the operator, who are currently flying it. I've never flown with China Eastern before. This is my first time on one of their planes, and everything's been really good. The staff speak multiple languages, English being one of them, so I've had no issues with communication. They've been checking in on me, making sure I'm okay, if I want to drink teas, coffees, and it's only a 2-hour flight, and yet you feel very well attended. So no issues whatsoever with China Eastern. Would happily fly them again, to be honest.
The future for the C919 and COMAC as a company as a whole is actually quite an interesting one. It's unlikely that in the short term, countries in the Asia Pacific outside of China will actually purchase Chinese aircraft. So you do wonder where the market for the COMAC aircraft is outside of China. Additionally, because of the US components that are in the aircraft, it's going to be difficult for COMAC to export the aircraft to countries that are under sanctions from the United States. But as I said earlier in this video, COMAC's plans for the future are enthusiastic, to say the least, because as well as the narrow body single aisle plane that I'm flying on now, the next aircraft they're looking to develop is the C929, which is a twin engine, twin aisle long range aircraft. After that, they want to develop the C939, a twin engine, twin aisle, ultra long range aircraft. And they even have plans in the future for a C949, which is a twin engine, single aisle, supersonic aircraft. How many of those aircraft we'll actually see, and if we do see them, when they'll actually be flying in our skies, is a complete unknown right now. But if they can get through those certification issues, and as the market opportunities grow for COMAC, perhaps we could see more COMAC aircraft in the skies in the future. And whilst it's probably quite unlikely that we'll see a COMAC C949 supersonic aircraft touching down at JFK anytime soon, I still reckon if you look up to the skies over Asia over the next couple of years, there's a strong chance that amongst the Airbuses and Boeings, you might be seeing more COMAC aircraft up there as well. Check out this next video right here. I think you'll really like this one. Thanks for watching.